it. The time is nearly up. Foley Key does not. Oh, there he is. Come in. You're quite wrong.
I'm not me, Paul. What does this mean?
It is absolutely necessary that we should have a talk with one another.
And is it absolutely necessary that it should be here?
Yes. It is impossible where I live. There are no private entrances to my rooms, but you're quite alone. The maid is asleep and the Helmers are at a dance upstairs.
Are the Helmers really at a dance upstairs?
Yes, why not?
Of course, why not?
Madam, let us have a talk.
Can you and I have anything to talk about?
We have a great deal to talk about.
I shouldn't have thought so.
No, you have never properly understood me.
What was there to understand except for what was so obvious to all the world? A heartless woman jilts a man when a more lucrative chance comes up.
Do you really believe I was as heartless as all that? And do you believe I did it with a light heart?
Didn't you?
Miles, did you really think that?
For as you say, why did you write to me as you did at the time?
I could do nothing else. As I had to put an end to it with you, I also had to put an end to all that you felt for me.
So that was it. All of that, only for the sake of money.
You must not forget I had a helpless mother and two little brothers. We couldn't wait for you, Niles. Your prospects seemed hopeless then.
That may be so, but you had no right to throw me out for anyone else's sake.
Indeed. I don't know. Many a time did I ask myself if I had the right to do it.
When I lost you, it was like all the solid ground went from under my feet. Look at me. I'm like a shipwrecked man clinging to a bit of wreckage.
But help made me near.
It was near. Then you came and stood in my way.
Unintentionally, Niles. It was only today that I learned it was your place I was to take in the bank.
But now that you know it, are you not going to give it up to me?
No, because that would not benefit you in the least.
Benefit? I would have done it whether or not.
I've learned to act prudently. Life and bitter necessity have taught me that.
And life has taught me not to believe in fine speeches.
Then life has taught you something very reasonable. But deeds you do believe in?
You mean?
You said you were like a shipwrecked man clinging to some wreckage.
Yes, and I had good reason to say so.
Well, I'm like a shipwrecked woman clinging to some wreckage. No one to mourn for, no one to care for.
That was your own choice.
There was no other choice. Then,
and now?
Miles, what would you say if we two shipwrecked people could join forces?
What are you saying?
Two on the same piece of wreckage would stand a better chance than each on their own.
Christine, I...
What do you think brought me to town?
Do you mean that you gave me a thought?
I could not endure life without work. All my life, as long as I can remember, I've worked, and it's been my greatest and only pleasure. But now I'm quite alone in the world. My life feels so dreadfully empty, and I feel so forsaken. There is not the least bit pleasure in working for oneself. Miles, give me someone and something to work for.
I don't trust that. It is nothing but a woman's overstrained sense of generosity that prompts you to make such an offer of yourself.
Have you ever noticed anything of the sort in me?
Could you do it? Really? Tell me, do you know what they think of me here?
Yes.
And do you know all about my past life?
You seem to me to imply that with me you might have been quite another man.
I'm certain of it.
Is it too late now?
Christine, are you saying this deliberately? Yes. I'm sure you are. I see it in your face.
Niles, I want to be a mother to someone, and your children need a mother. We two need each other, Niles. I have faith in your real character. I can dare anything together with you.
Thanks, Christine. If If only I could find some way to redeem myself.
The Tarantella, go, go.
Why, what is it?
Do you hear that up there? When that is over, you may expect them back.
Yes, I will go, but it is of no use. Of course, you are not aware what steps I have taken in the matter of the Helmers.
Yes, I know all about that.
And in spite of that, you have the courage to...
I understand what lengths a man like you may be driven by despair.
If only I could undo what I have done.
You cannot. Your letter is lying in the letterbox.
Are you sure of that?
Quite sure.
Wait, is that what this all means? That you want to save your friend at any cost? Tell me, is that it?
Niles, a woman who has once sold herself for another's sake doesn't do it a second time.
I will ask for my letter back.
No, no.
Yes, I will wait here until Hemmer returns. I will demand that he give me my letter back, that he need not read it. It only concerns my dismissal.
Niles, you must not recall your letter.
Wasn't it for that very purpose that you called me here tonight?
In my first moment of fright it was, but 24 hours have elapsed since then, and I have witnessed incredible things in this house. Helmer must know all about it. They must have a complete understanding between them, which is impossible with all this concealment and falsehood going on.
Very well. We'll take the responsibility, but there's something I can do in any case, and I shall do it at once.
Go! The song is over. We're not safe a moment longer.
I will wait for you below.
Yes, you must see me to my door.
I've never had such an amazing piece of good fortune in my life.
My darling Nora.
Yes, Torvald, please, just an hour more.
Not a single minute, my darling Nora. You know that was agreement. Come along into the...
Good evening.
You're here so late, Mrs. Lind.
Yes, I was just so anxious to see Nora in her dress.
Have you been sitting here waiting for me?
Yes. Unfortunately, I came too late. You had already gone upstairs. And I just thought I couldn't go away again without having seen her. Yes.
I think she is quite worth looking at. Isn't she charming, Mrs. Lind?
Yes, indeed she is.
Doesn't she look remarkably pretty? Everyone thought so at the dance, but she's terribly self-willed, this sweet little person. What are we going to do with her? You will hardly believe that I almost had to take her away by force.
Horrible.
You
repent not having let me stay
even
half an hour more.
Just listen to her, Mrs. Lind. She had danced her tarantella and had been a tremendous success. A little more so, I mean, and was strictly compatible with the limitations of art. But never mind about that. She had made a success. She made a tremendous success. Do you think I was going to let her stay there and ruin the effect? No, indeed. I take my charming little Capri maiden, my capricious little Capri maiden, I should say, on my arm, one quick turn around the room and a curtsy on the other side, and as I say in the novels, the beautiful apparition disappeared. An exit ought to always be effective, Mrs. Lind, but that is one thing I can't get Nora to understand. It is hot in here. Of course, excuse me.
Well, I have had a talk with him.
Yes, and?
Nora, you must tell your husband all about it.
I knew it.
You have nothing to be afraid of as far as Krogstad is concerned, but you must tell him.
I won't tell him.
Then the letter will.
Thank you. Christine, I know what I must do.
Well, Mrs. Lind, have you admired her?
Yes, and now I will say goodnight.
What? Already? Oh. I found some knitting in my office. Is it yours? Oh, thank you, Helen.
Oh, yes, thank you. I had very nearly forgotten it.
So you knit?
Of course.
Do you know you ought to embroider?
Really? Why?
Yes, it's far more becoming. Let me show you. So, you hold the embroidery thus in your left hand and use the knitting needle with your right with a long, easy sweep. Do you see?
Yes. Perhaps.
But in the case of knitting, that can never be anything but ungraceful. The knitting arms close together, the knitting needles going up and down, has a sort of Chinese effect. That was really excellent champagne they gave us.
Good night, Nora, and don't be self-willed anymore.
That's right, Mrs. Lind.
Good night, Mr. Homer.
Good night. Good night. I should be very happy to, but you don't have very far distance to go. Good night. Good night. At last, we've got rid of her. She was a frightful bore, that woman.
Mm-hmm. Aren't you very tired?
No. Not in the least.
Nor sleepy.
Not a bit. If anything, I feel extraordinarily lively. Do you? You really look both tired and sleepy.
Yes, I am very tired.
There, you see, it was quite right of me not to let you stay there any longer.
Yes, Torvald, everything you do is quite right.
Oh, now my little Skylark is speaking reasonably. But did you happen to see what good spirits Rank was in this evening?
Really? I'm blushing. I didn't speak to her at all.
Yes, and I very little, but I've never seen her in such good form. Nora, it's delightful to be at home by ourselves again. To be all alone with you, my sweet, charming little darling.
Don't look at me like that, Torvald.
Why should I look at all the beauty that is mine, my dearest treasure? That is also very mine, my very own.
You mustn't say things like that to me tonight.
Ah, I see you've still got the Tarantelle in your blood, I see. And has made you more captivating than ever. Nora, listen, the guests are beginning to go now. Soon the whole place will be quiet.
Yes, I hope so.
Do you know why, when we are at a party like this, why I speak so little to you and only keep so far away and send a stolen glance in your direction every now and then? Do you know why it is I do that? It's because I make believe we are secretly in love and you are my secretly promised bride and no one suspects there is anything between us.
Yes, Torvald, I know very well that your thoughts are with me all the time.
And when I'm putting the shawl over your beautiful young shoulders, over your lovely neck, why, I think that we have just been married. I'm bringing you into my home for the first time. To be all alone with you, my shy, charming little darling. When I watched seductive figures of the Tarantella, my blood was on fire. I could not think of anything else. I couldn't endure no longer. And that was why I brought you down so early, Nora.
Let me go. Torvald, go away.
What?
I won't.
You won't? Am I not your husband? You won't. You won't. Who is that?
Here.
Who is it?
It is I. May I come in for a moment?
What does she want now? Wait a minute. Ah, yes, it was quite kind of you not to pass by our door.
I thought I heard your voice and felt as if I should like to look in for a moment. These dear familiar rooms, you are quite happy and cozy in here, you two.
And you seem to look quite well after yourself up too, Dr. Rank.
Absolutely. But why should one enjoy everything in this life? At any rate, as much as one can, and as long as one can. The wine was capital.
Especially the champagne.
So you noticed that too?
Sure.
It is almost incredible how much I managed to put away.
Grumwald drank a great deal of champagne tonight, too.
Did he?
Yes. He's always in good spirits afterwards.
Well, why shouldn't one enjoy a merry evening after a well-spent day?
Well-spent? I'm afraid I can't take credit for that.
But I can, you know. Dr. Rank, were you occupied with some scientific investigation today?
Exactly.
Oh, look at that, little Nora talking about scientific investigation.
May I congratulate you on the results?
Indeed you may.
They were favorable then?
The best possible for both doctor and patient.
Certainty.
Certainty. Absolute certainty. So wasn't I entitled to make a merry evening of it after that?
Yes, I believe you were, Dr. Rank.
I think so too, so long as you don't have to pay for it in the morning.
Well, my dear friend, you can't have anything in this life without paying for it. But I have clean forgot what I have come for. Helmer, give me a cigar. One of the darker things.
Greatest pleasure.
Let me get you a light.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. And now, good night.
Good night. Good night, dear lady. Sleep well, Dr. Rank.
Thank you for that wish.
Wish me the same. You? Well, if you wish me to sleep well.
And thanks for the light.
She's drunk more than she ought.
trying to do? Are you...
emptying the litter box. It's quite full. There will be no room for the newspaper in the morning.
Are you going to work?
You know I'm not. Nora! Someone has been at the lock.
At the lock?
Yes. Someone has, but I found a broken hairpin. Nora, it's one of yours.
Oh, then it must have been the children.
Ah, then you must get them out of those ways. Look here, look what a heap of them there are.
No, tore all the letter, don't.
Two cards. Ranks.
Dr. Ranks?
Yes, she must have put them in when she went out.
Is there anything written on them?
It's as if she put a black cross over them. Oh my, it looks as if she were announcing her own death.
That's exactly what she's doing.
What? She said anything. Do you know anything about this?
Yes, she told me that when the cards came, it would be her leave-taking from us.
My poor old friend.
She tends to shut herself up and die.
Certainly I knew we should not have her for so long, but so soon. So she hides herself like a wounded animal.
To happen, it's best it should be without a word. Don't you think so, Torvald?
She had so grown into our lives. She, with her sufferings and her loneliness, was like a cloudy background to our sunlit happiness. Well, perhaps it is best so. For her, anyway. Perhaps for us, too. Nora, you two are quite thrown into each other. My darling Nora, I cannot hold you tight enough. Do you know that sometimes I wish you might be threatened by some great danger so I might risk my life's blood and everything for your sake?
You'll never have to do that. Read your letters, Torvald.
No, my darling Nora. I wish to be with you.
No, with the thought of your friend's death.
You are right. Something ugly has come between us. Thoughts on the horrors of death. We must try and rid our minds of that. And until then, we will each go to our own rooms.
Good night, Bill.
Good night. Good night, my darling Nora. Sleep sound. Now, I will read my letters through.
He's got it. Never to see him again. Never. Never. I never to see my children again either. If only it were over.
Destroyed my future! You've put me in the power of an unscrupulous man, and he can do what he likes with me.
Afterwards, when I'm gone.
Ask anything he likes of me. Orders me around, and I must do so because of a thoughtless woman. Do you understand what you have done? Do you think it would do me any good for you to be gone as you say? Certainly not. For he can publish it everywhere and make it known to the world. And when he does, people will think that I was behind it. That I may have been a party to your criminal action. Very likely people will think that I was behind it all. And I have to thank you because you gave a thoughtless promise, because you are a thoughtless woman. Nora, we must hush it up at any cost. We must appease him in some way. Take off that shawl. Take it off, I tell you! We must make it as though nothing has happened. We must make it seem as if nothing has changed between us, but only in the eyes of the world. And for that matter, will stay here in my home as my wife, but only in appearance. And on that note, I shall not trust you to the children. I shall not trust you to my children. And to think that I should be obliged to do so, to say so to one whom I loved, one whom I still... No, that is all over. From now on, happiness isn't the question. What concerns us now is to save the remains, the appearance, the fragments. What is that? Could it be he? Nora, hide yourself! Say you are ill!
A letter for the mistress.
Yes, it's from him. You shall not have it. I shall read it myself.
It's just...
If only I have the courage to, Nora. I should not like to see what is in this letter, but I must. Nora! No, I must look at this again. Nora! I am saved!
And I?
You too, of course. Both you and I. He sends you back your bond. In this letter, he says that a good change in this life, that something has happened, but never mind about that. Nora, nothing shall happen to you. No one can do anything to you. But, no, I must destroy these hateful things. But, no, I must not look at that. They're now. They're gone. Destroyed. Nora. Everything is over. From now on, you can shout with joy and say, it's all over. It's all over. What is this? Listen to me, Nora. Believe me. What is this cold, set face? Nora, I can understand that you don't believe that I have forgiven you, but I know that what you've done out of great love for me.
That is true.
You have loved a man as a wife ought to, but you had no reason to judge of the means you used. And do you think I would not consider you any more less dear to me because you don't know how to act on your own responsibility? No. For if anything, I have forgiven you, and for that, it was as if that you have gained a double attractiveness in my way. Nora, what is this? You don't seem to understand that I've forgiven you freely and for everything.
Thank you for your forgiveness.
Nora, where are you going? What are you doing in there? Yes. Take off your dress and calm yourself. Do, Sigmora. Try and make your mind at ease again, my frightened little singing bird. Be at rest and feel secured. For there is great shelter for you here, Nora. How warm and cozy our home is, Nora. Here is shelter for you, for I have great wings for you, Nora, to put you under. You are like a frightened dove that I have saved from a hawk's claws. I will bring peace to your poor beating heart, Nora. Little by little. Tomorrow morning, you will see that it was just as it was before. That nothing has changed. Can you ever suppose that I can ever think of reproaching you or even repudiating you? No. For you can't understand what a man is like, nor what their mind is like. To forgive him. To give forgiveness to his wife. And if anything, that had made her doubly his own. It was as if, as it were, she became both wife and child to him. And so you shall be so for me too, Nora. For I shall serve as both will and conscience to you. You just have to believe me that I have forgiven you. But what is this? Have you changed?
Yes, Jorval, I've changed.
But what for? So late as this?
I'm not sleeping tonight.
My dear Nora.
Sit down, Jorval. We have a lot to talk about.
What do you mean?
Sit down. This might take a while. Oh, I have a lot to say to you.
You really do alarm me, Nora. I don't understand you.
That's just it. You've never understood me. And I've never understood you either. Before tonight. No, don't try to interrupt me. Just listen to me. Well, let me set you straight.
What do you mean by that? What is that?
We've been married for 8 years, Torvald. And this is the first time that you and I, husband and wife, have had a serious conversation.
What do you mean by serious?
For the past 8 years? No. Longer than that. Since we met, you and I have never said anything serious.
Would it be because I would be continually and forever telling you about worries you cannot help me to bear?
I'm not talking about business, Torvald. You and I have never sat down to try and get to the bottom of anything.
But Nora, would it have done you any good?
That's just it. You've never understood me. I have been greatly wronged, Torvald. First by Papa.
By us two? By us two who have loved you more than anyone else in the world?
You never loved me. Torvald, you only thought it would be nice to be in love with me.
Nora, what do I hear you say?
It's so true, Torvald. When I lived at home with Papa when I was younger, he called me his doll child. He played with me just as I used to play with my dolls. He told me his opinion about everything. And if I disagreed with him, I hid it because he wouldn't have liked it. And then when I came to live here with you...
What sort of an expression is that to use about our marriage?
Papa's hands to yours. You fix everything how you see fit, Torvald, and so I have to have the same taste, or else I pretended to. I don't know which. I think sometimes one and sometimes the other. Looking back, I realize that I've been living here like a poor woman, just from hand to mouth. I've existed merely to perform tricks for you, Torvald. You wanted it that way! It's your fault that I've never made anything of my life. You and Papa ruined me.
how ungrateful and unreasonable you are. Have you not been happy here?
No, I've not been happy. Thought I was. I was wrong.
Not happy?
No. Only cheerful. Our house has been a playroom, Torvald. I've been your doll wife. Just like when I was younger, I was Papa's doll child, and here the children have been my dolls. I thought it's so fun when you played with me, just as they think it's so fun when I play with them. That's what our marriage has been, Torvald.
There is some truth in what you say, though exaggerated and stranger view of it is. But for the future, playtime shall be over, and lesson time shall begin.
Whose lessons? Mine or the children's?
Both yours and the children's, Nora.
Torvald, you're not the kind of person who could teach me how to be a wife for you.
And you can say that.
And I... Torvald, what do I know about raising the kids?
Nora!
No! It's so true. Didn't you just say you dare not trust me to raise them?
In a moment of anger. Why would you pay any heed to that?
Because you are absolutely right. I can't do that. There's something else I have to do first. I have to try to educate myself.
What do you mean?
I can't do that here. And that's why I'm leaving you.
What do you say?
I have to stand alone. If I'm to understand myself and everything about me, Torvald, and I can't do that here. I can't stay.
Nora.
I'll leave tonight.
No.
I'm sure Christine will let me spend the night.
No, that is sheer madness. I won't allow it. I forbid you.
You can't tell me what to do anymore, Torvald. Don't worry. I won't take anything of yours, now or later.
What sort of madness is this?
I'm going home tomorrow to my old home. It'll be easier to find work there.
You blind, foolish woman.
I need some space, Torvald.
To desert your home? Your children and your husband? And you care not what people will say?
I can't think about what people will say, Torvald. I can only do what's best for me.
It's shocking to think that this is how you neglect your most sacred duties.
What do you think are my most sacred duties?
Do I really need to remind you of that? Are they not your duties to your husband and children?
I have other duties just as sacred.
Those you have not.
Indeed I do.
What could those be?
Duties to myself.
Before all else, you are a wife and a mother.
I don't believe that anymore. Before all else, I now believe that I am a reasonable human being, just as you are. Or in any case, that I must try to become one. I'm well aware, Torvald, that most people think that you're right. And the Bible says that too. That I can't just go along with what people say or what is found in church. I have to think for myself.
What do I hear you say? Have you no religion?
Honestly, Torvald, I don't really know what religion is.
Nora.
I only know what the priest told me when I was confirmed. He told me that religion was this and that and the other. When I'm gone and alone, Torvald, I'll think on that too.
Nora. If religion cannot lead you aright, let me try and awaken your conscience. Or am I to think that you have none?
Honestly, Torvald, I don't really know. It's also confusing. I do know you and I see it very differently. I'm learning now, too, that the law isn't what I thought it was. That I can't believe that the law is right. According to it, a woman has no right to spare her old dying father anxiety and care and save her husband's life. I can't believe that.
Nora, you talk and think like a heedless child? Have you no idea of the conditions of the world in which you live?
Guess I don't. But now I'm gonna try.
Laura, what are you saying?
I have to go, Torvald, for myself.
No, Nora. I see that an abyss has opened between us.
Torvald, there's really only one explanation. I don't love you anymore.
What? And is it with a...
It hurts me to say so, Torvald, because you've always been so kind, but... I don't love you anymore.
Nora, and you say that with a clear and certain mind too?
Yes, absolutely. And I can tell you why.
Can you explain yourself to me? I don't understand you.
Torvald, when the wonderful thing did not happen, I saw you were not the man I thought you were.
Explain yourself better.
I've waited 8 years, Torvald, because I know that wonderful things don't happen every day. But this terrible thing happened, and I was so certain that the wonderful thing was finally gonna happen too. Never for a moment, while that letter was lying out there, did I imagine that you would just cave to him. I thought you would say, fine, publish the thing to the whole world, and when that was done...
Yes! What then? When I had exposed my wife to shame and disgrace?
When that was done, I was so sure you would come forward and say, yes, I take the blame. I'm the guilty one. Do you really think I wouldn't do that for you?
Nora.
Of course not. What's my word against yours? And that was the wonderful thing I hoped for and feared, Torvald. And to avoid that, I wanted to kill myself.
Nora, I would bear want and sorrow for your sake. But no man would risk his reputation for the one he loves.
It is a thing hundreds of thousands of women have done.
Oh, you think and talk like a heedless child!
Maybe! But you don't think or talk like a man I could bind myself to. Torvald, as soon as your fear for what might happen was over, and no, you were not afraid for me, but for what might happen to you. As soon as your fear was over, as far as you were concerned, it was like nothing had happened at all. Once more, I was your little skylark, your doll, which you would then treat as if I were even more delicate than before. Torvald, it was then that I realized that for 8 years I have been living with a stranger and have given him 4 children! I can't think of it. I could rip myself apart.
I see. An abyss has opened between us, Nora. Tell me, is it not possible to fill it up again?
As I am now, I am no wife for you.
Nora? I have it in me to become a different man.
Maybe, if your doll is taken away.
But to part from you, Nora. No, I can't entertain that idea. I can't understand it. I can't bear it.
Then I have to go.
No, 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 not now, Nora. Wait
Goodbye.
Until tomorrow.
I can't spend the night in a stranger's house.
And can't we live here like brother and sister?
You know that. Goodbye. Torvald, I will not see the kids. I know Anne will take care of them better than I ever could.
But shall you never think of me or the children again?
When a wife leaves her husband,
Nora, before us, you are a wife to me!
He is no longer legally obligated to her. In any case, I free you from all your obligations. You'll be just as free as me. There has to be absolute freedom on both sides. See, here's your ring. Give me mine.
everything in the house even better than I do.
Nora, can I ever write to you?
No, don't. Never.
Can I ever send you anything?
Nothing. Nothing.
May I ever help you if you are in want?
I can't take anything from a stranger.
Nora.
No.
Can I never be anything more than a stranger to you?
Torvald, the most wonderful thing of all would have to happen.
Tell me what that would be!
You and I would both have to change so much that... Torvald, I don't believe in wonderful things anymore.
I will. So change
our life together would be a life in chains. Goodbye.
No! Nora! Nora! Empty. She's gone. The most wonderful thing of all.